Well, I don't know about you. That gets me fired up. I don't know if I'd be as fired up if I was actually one of those guys, right? I mean, what an interesting time in that day, in that kind of warfare, where you had to, really man up. to run headlong into the battle. And yet, from a spiritual perspective, we live in a day that has, I believe, seeing as much or if not more evil than ever before. We live in a world where the enemy knows his day is coming to an end to wreak havoc on this planet. So what is he going to do? He's going to try to wreck as many lives as possible. He's going to try to steal from your future if possible. He's going to try to destroy all that he can. And so we must become this army that is fighting side by side to see the enemy defeated. When kingdoms collide, and whether you can see it or not, remember, this is happening every day. Like even right now, in this moment, there is a fight going on in the spiritual realm that we cannot see, yet that battle is real and it rages for lives. And maybe even today you are in a scenario where you are in a battle and you're praying and you're seeking God for breakthrough. I want you to know that the power of prayer is real. That there is no doubt in my mind when we pray and we believe that God can and will answer those prayers. Now, it may not always be like we think it should be. It may not always look the way we think it should look. Nevertheless, God can take all circumstances that you face, and he can work those things out for the good. Amen? He can work things out. So who is our enemy? So we're going to recap real quick, try to get everybody back to speed, and then we're going to finish this off today. Who is our enemy? We know it's the devil. We know it's Satan. Diablos, the devil, is looking to destroy. And how does he do that? How does he destroy? He destroys by backbiting. He destroys by slandering, by falsely accusing, unjustly criticizing you to hurt you, condemning people to sever relationships. That's the devil. That's how he works, because he wants to destroy the body of Christ. But many times we focus on the flesh, and it is never the person beside you or the person at work or anybody in the flesh that is your battle. Your battle is not against flesh and blood. 2 Corinthians 10:3 through 5. For though we walk in the flesh, we are not waging war according to the flesh, for the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but have divine power to destroy strongholds. Come on, somebody. Have divine power to destroy strongholds. Say that with me. Have divine power to destroy strongholds. Now, somebody say that like you got the power of the Holy Spirit behind you. Have divine power to
destroy.
Come on, destroy strongholds. That doesn't mean you kind of win, right? It doesn't mean we barely win. We destroy strongholds. We obliterate strongholds. We are more than conquerors through the blood of Christ Jesus, right? More than conquerors. I remember one time when I was in high school and our football team. I grew up in Osceola. How many know Clark Indians? How many have heard of that on, if you're watching the news? Like most of the time nowadays, now their softball team, I think, is actually doing right. Or until they just got wiped out, like 15 to nothing or something like that. But they made it to, I think, state or something. Traditionally, that hasn't happened well for the Clark Indians. Like, they haven't been good. Like, they get wiped out every year. But there was a few years when I was in high school that a couple classes before me and then my class, we had a good football team. We had a good wrestling team. And I remember one year for homecoming. And how many understand that homecoming, if there's ever a game you want to win well, it's homecoming. How many know? Right? And I remember one year at homecoming, we were playing Sadel. Now, I'm not going to say much about that. Keep in mind when we moved to Des Moines, we actually lived in that school district. My kids went to that school. And so I can't say much for Sadell's athletic program as well. But nevertheless, we played a football game in homecoming. And I remember, I think we ended up something like 49-3 in our favor. And that's a good thing. That excites me because I was the kicker. Well, actually, in a small town, you're everything. Like, let's be honest. Like, it's not like playing at Valley or Dowling or somewhere where you've got all kinds of people to choose from. You basically have enough players to cover the line. And so you play offense, you play defense, you play special teams, and anything else you can do. And so I was the offensive center on the offensive side. I was defensive right tackle on the defense, and I was kicker in special teams. And so it's awesome for me to be able to get in there. I can just remember having one of the best games ever in that homecoming. And I thought, that's being more than a conqueror. It's not just barely winning your game. And folks, I need you to know something. Jesus didn't barely win. He didn't kind of make it. It didn't kind of work out for him. The enemy thought he had Jesus defeated, but Jesus came back and obliterated the enemy. And he won the victory for every person sitting in this room today. He won the victory for everyone across the planet. He took all of their sin upon himself, and he destroyed death, hell, and the grave. He won handily. That's the God you serve. We don't barely make it. That we have the divine power through the Holy Spirit to destroy strongholds. We destroy arguments and every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of God and take every thought captive to obey Christ. So that's who our enemy is. It's not the flesh. It's the devil. It's the spiritual things that we fight against. So we must set that right every morning you wake up. You have to determine this is not about anybody in the flesh. This is about the enemy today that is unseen. I didn't think that was going to stand there as much as I jump around. So the next question is how do we win a battle against another kingdom when it seems like we're outnumbered? Remember? Right? So we know who the enemy is, and sometimes you feel like you're outnumbered. And remember that the Lord's thinking is different from our thinking. See, we would never be bummed out to have too many resources, would we? Right? If we had all the money we could handle, we wouldn't be bummed out about that. How many would be bummed out if you had all the money you could handle? Right? How many would be bummed out if you had all the things you possibly needed for your work or for your home life? I mean, if you had all the resources possible, you probably wouldn't be bummed out about that. We would never fear that. But see, Judges chapter 7, verse 2 is one of the most important verses in the Bible because it's this principle of spiritual warfare. See, God is not simply interested in giving you a victory. He's concerned with teaching us to trust Him no matter what the circumstance is. Because you can trust God when things are good. How many can trust Him when things are good? The issue is learning to trust God when things aren't so good. When you are going through a physical situation, you are going through a home situation, you're going through a I need a job situation, you don't have every resource you need. It's in those moments that you have to learn to trust Him, that He still has your best interest in mind. What did the Lord say to Gideon? Verse 2. The Lord said to Gideon, "You have too many warriors with you. If I let all of you fight against the Midianites, then the Israelites will boast to me that they saved themselves by their own strength." See, sometimes we get happy about what we can accomplish, what we can do. And I think that might be more of a man thing than a woman thing. But I think women, you probably struggle in that area too sometimes. It's what can you do to accomplish what you need to accomplish in life? 135,000 soldiers against 300. 450-1 odds. How many are ready to rush into that battle? Right? You got your sword, you got your shield, you got your helmet and your shoes and your belt and your breastplate, and you're like, yes, I'm ready to take on 450. That's almost, it's not quite, but it's almost like me saying, okay, all of you right now, let's roll. Come on, let's go. Me against all of you. And I've seen a few guys in this room that are pretty big. I mean, I feel good. My odds, I think I would hold my own in any given situation, but there's a few guys in this room that'd be like, Jesus, I'm going to rethink this one. Right? Now, of course, you do have the equalizer, right? 451. Man, what odds. But God likes these kind of odds, folks. He's not scared of those odds. And we have to put our faith and our trust and our hope in Him that He's fighting the battle and we aren't fighting the battle. If you fight the battle in your own strength, you better be worried. You better know that you're not going to make it through this life if you try to do it on your own and in your own strength. But in Him, all things are what? Possible, right? In Him, we don't have to be afraid. In Him, we don't have to have a doubt. In Him, we don't have to be timid. I mean, you got the Father, right? You got the one who defeated every other opponent for you, and He's with you. You don't have to be afraid. We have to be alert. We have to know that there's a battle that's raging. We have to keep our heads up and let God's power win the battle. I remember another time I was a little guy, and I was in my dad's store. He was a manager of a True Value store when I grew up as a kid, and my grandpa owned the store. And I remember going to, there was one gentleman that worked there that was a little difficult to deal with. And he, for some reason, I think he just didn't like me that much. I was the little kid of the manager of the hardware store, and I liked to go up there and hang out around my grandpa and hang around my dad. And I remember one time in particular, I went up to my dad and I said, "Hey, Dad, I'm looking, I'd like to get a knife, right? I'd like to get a little pocket knife." And he's like, "Well, son, why don't you just run downstairs to the counter and look at some of the pocket knives and ask the guy to show it to you and tell him I said it was okay." And I said, "Awesome. Dad said it was okay." Come on, how many remember a moment in your life where dad or mom said it was okay? I mean, all of a sudden you got this confidence. I remember going downstairs and going up to the counter and saying, "Hey, I would like to look at this knife. Dad said it was okay." "Well, I'm going to have to ask him." So what you're saying is you don't believe me that dad said it was okay. And see, I think there's that element of we have this faith that there is a Father in heaven who has your best interest in mind and gives you access to what you need. But when you speak, "Dad says it's okay," do you really believe it? Do you really trust? And I remember I was distraught. I said, "No, he really did." He goes, "Well, I'll have to ask him myself." And I'm like, "Well, I'll just go get him." Right? I remember I was upset. Because I was probably fifth or sixth grade. I was a little emotional, you know. I can remember going back up the stairs, and I may have had a tear in the eye or something, like, "Dad, he won't let me look." I remember the look in my dad's face. And I saw this thing come over him, and I was like, "Whoa." And I remember him getting up from his desk and walking through the door and heading out, and I'm like, "This is gonna be awesome." And here I am, a little guy, walking behind my 6'3" dad, you know, and going down the stairs and walking up to the counter. And now I'm not approving of what my dad just said. My dad used an expletive. But I can remember him slamming his hand down on the counter and saying something with the guy's name following. And he says, "When I give my son permission, then I expect that you do it." And let me tell you what a son feels like in that moment. He says, "That's my dad." Come on, somebody. My dad is bigger than your dad, right? My dad is stronger than your dad. There's this confidence. And folks, what I want you to walk away from here today understanding is your father is bigger than any other one that wants to proclaim they are a father in this world. You have a bigger father. But you have to trust that. You have to put your faith in that. You can't walk in front of the Father. The issue is taking your stance behind the Father, right? This is my Father. This is my Dad. And I'm going to walk in His strength, not in mine. There, it's way different when you have under 5 foot, sixth grade dude. And I grew a lot. Like seventh grade, I was still 5 foot. I was a small little kid. And every year after that, I grew 2 inches all the way through when I graduated. And I was so thankful for that. Right? I never did catch my dad. I always wanted to be as big as my dad. But you know what? When we walk behind the power of Dad and not in front of Him, there is a confidence that we can carry. And I want you today to know that whatever battle rages, whatever you're colliding against in life, walk with your Father. Walk in His strength, walk in His power, and see what He will do. If we do it in our own strength, and maybe you happen to win a battle, remember, our victories, if they make us self-reliant, they're more disastrous than if we're defeated in particular. Right? If we win, and all of a sudden now we're self-reliant on us and what we're capable of, now we are in trouble. Because now we're going to do it in our own strength all the time. And we'll only call on Him when? We'll only call on Him if it's a disaster. And that tends to be what we do as children. We call on Him in the midst of disaster. Warren Wetherby said, remember, a faith that can't be tested can't be trusted. Say it. A faith that can't be tested can't be trusted. J.G. Stipe said that faith is like a toothbrush. Somebody was asking me about this quote. A faith is like a toothbrush. Everybody should have one and use it regular, and all God's people said. But it isn't safe to use somebody else's. Right? You don't just typically go into, well, I think most of you don't typically do this. Some of you might. But you typically don't go in and grab one of the other 5 toothbrushes that's sitting around the counter. You look for your color, right? You try to color code those so you know there's not a mistake. You purposely buy different colors if you have multiple people in your household. How many know what I'm saying? You don't just buy the same color and guess. I don't, maybe you have more faith than I do. Maybe you do that. You're like, okay, we're buying all the same color, and you're going to have to just guess which one is yours. I don't know how you would do that unless you picked it up and smelled it or something. I don't know. Listen, we can celebrate the faith of the people that went before us, our forefathers, the people who laid the foundation. We can celebrate all the great things that happened to get us to this point in life. But if we're going to win today, we have to exercise our own faith. We can't live off their faith. Amen? Now remember the 300-foot redwood, right? Its roots go out 900. It intertwines with all the other trees around it. By the time a few hundred years go by, the roots are so woven together that there's no way a tree is going to fall down. It's held up by the strength of its brothers and sisters. How many were here for that message that day where we joined hands together? See, there is strength in that. We have to stand together. We are the church no matter what. It is never the building that's the church. It's never the activity that's the church. It's the people. It's you. It's me. We are the church together. And where we go together. We lock arms, we lift one another up, we pray, we believe, we serve together. Jesus said in John 17, He said, I am praying not only for these disciples, but also for all who will ever believe in Me because of their testimony. My prayer for all of them is that they will be one just as you and I are one, right? We are one. We're all sitting in separate seats, but we're one. We stand together. Father, that just as You are in Me and I am in You, so they will be in us and the world will believe You sent Me. Okay, so that's where we're coming from. Who is the enemy? What happens when we feel like we're outnumbered? If we stand together, we can win. If we stand in Christ, if we walk behind the Father, we can win. Now, let's today look at how do we, in the midst of kingdoms that are colliding, what kind of armor do we have to have in the battle? How do we arm ourselves every day for this battle? We can read the front side of this, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10 through 12. If you've got your Bibles, we'll have stuff up on the screen too, but it's good to know where this is at, good to underline it. Be in your word. Ephesians 6, 10 through 12. Finally, say it with me, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of His might. Say that again. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of His might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. That cannot be stated enough times, folks. And you can't say it enough times. In the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the devil's scheme. The devil is scheming to destroy your family, your life, everything he can do to mess you up. He schemes on a regular basis and he knows your weakness. How many know he knows your weakness? How many feel like there have been times you get tripped up by the same thing over and over again? How many have felt that a time or two? It's like, why do I get tripped up by the same thing? Why? Because the devil knows your weakness, and he's coming after it. Therefore, if you walk around in your own flesh, you can't win, because he's going to attack that. That's why you have to stand behind your Father in the power of what? His might. You have to put on the full armor of God. You don't put on a little of the armor of God. You don't pick and choose which pieces you put on. I mean, you have to get all of it on. Every day when you wake up, you need to put on the full armor of God, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly places. Now, I'm going to read this, and then we're going to go through it. Ephesians chapter 6, 13 through 20, it says, therefore take up the what? Whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. And having done all to stand firm, stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and the shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith, which can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. To that end, be alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints and also for me, that words may be given to me, opening my mouth boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that I might declare it boldly as I ought to speak. Amen. Hey, brother, up there, I'm going to have you switch me over to this mic right here.
To check.
And it doesn't matter to me if it's a headset or wireless. What matters to me is that this gets proclaimed properly, and feedback will kill me.
We've got to put on the whole armor of God. Everything. It's not about deciding which you're going to put on. And I want you to see this a little bit differently. We're going to talk about each piece of the armor in particular, but in prayer meeting last week or the week before, as I was praying over this particular piece of scripture, I felt like I saw it in a different way that I've never seen it before. And that is this: God's armor is one piece. Now, there's separate components that kind of cover our body, but we can't think that it's up to us to remember to put it all on and forget. He is one, right? All of his armor is one piece of armor. And it's like this. It's like as if, how many have seen one of those in a movie, the full body armor guy that's standing there. How many know what I'm saying? All metal, right? Just kind of propped up against the wall. So you got the everything. It's just one piece of armor, and the shield is there, and the sword is there. And so I want you to, in your mind, I want you to visualize that right here on the stage right now. Everybody ready? How many see the body armor? Ready? One, two, three, bam, right there. Got it? And so we've got this entire piece of body armor, all the way from the feet, all the way up to the knees, the chest, the helmet, the sword, the shield. It's all right there. And as I was laying there and praying, I felt like what God spoke to my spirit in that moment was, I have to stop thinking about how it's my strength that puts the helmet on and the belt on, and I got to worry if I'm going to forget a piece today. That he's already complete, and all I have to do is this. Step into it. Come on. Do you see that? You need to know that it's in the power of his might, right? So put on the full armor of God. I mean, right now, when you wake up in the morning, you don't have to wonder, okay, am I going to forget something? I don't know if I've got my shield, if I got my shoes, if I got my helmet, my belt, my breastplate. Did I remember it all? You don't have to. You simply have to walk over and step into it. Step into his full armor and trust that he's going to take care of you. Man, how much fear do you have now? Right? 450-1 odds? No worries. I got full body armor and you got none. Right? You can throw a rock at me. Everybody can start throwing rocks. I'm in full body armor right now. Having done all to stand therefore. Man, isn't there comfort in knowing that you can just stand in his power and know that you've got everything in place to extinguish every fiery dart, everything that wants to destroy you? You can just stand in his strength and in his power. I want you to see that, even though we're going to talk about each one individually. Every Christian needs to know how to battle evil, but most people don't want to acknowledge that evil is real. Folks, I'm telling you, until you realize there is an evil and it is real, then we won't ever step into the power of God the way we need to. You won't ever fight for your family the way you need to. Right? You won't ever fight for your friends or your loved ones like you need to if you don't believe there's an evil that's trying to kill and destroy them. But when you understand it and know it, that there are fiery darts coming, you want to arm yourself and you want to go out and protect the people that you love. Every Christian has to battle, but there's detailed destruction, so we get into it, right? The belt of truth. Stand therefore having fastened the belt of truth. Now that's important, fastening the belt. How many believe it's important to fasten your belt? How many have had pants? I'm not saying it happens often, but right now, you know, I'm in this stage where I've lost some weight, and when you get into that mode where you lose some weight, sometimes the pants don't fit just the way they should. How many have been there? Okay? Maybe you've always had a trial with that. Well, God bless you. I wish I had that trial all the time. But it's fastening that belt because would you be so honest? Would somebody be so honest? Maybe you're just going to chuckle and then I'll know. Would you be so honest to say you forgot the belt one time? Or you didn't latch it to as tight as you should have, and you're doing something, and you forget, and all of a sudden your pants start wiggling down a little bit, and you're like, whoa! Right? You had to stop and freeze in that moment, or there was embarrassment coming. How many know what I'm saying? Okay, I got a few honest people. Can you imagine, like, I'm this fierce warrior for God, and I'm on the battlefield, and I begin to run at the enemy. All of a sudden, I realize my belt wasn't latched. And my pants drop. I got my sword and my shield and my pants are around my ankles. How many know that's a bad moment on the battlefield? And your enemies stop. And you're like, yeah. And then they begin to laugh. And you're like, ooh. Right? We have a belt that we need to latch. But let me tell you something. The belt of truth, it involves a couple places. It involves your heart and it involves your mind. If you do not belt things right, if you do not put the belt of truth on and guard your mind and guard your heart, that's where things go bad right away. It's like literally being caught with your pants around your ankles, right? If you don't have truth, you're not going to win any battle. Amen? Right? So if you don't have truth in your heart, if you don't have truth in your mind, the battle is over before it begins. We have to have the belt of what? Truth. Truth keeps us secure in Christ. It makes all the other pieces of armor effective. It works. Like if your pants don't fall down, everything else is looking better. It's a brighter day. The belt of truth holds things in place. It's a daily commitment to walk in the light of God's truth. Psalm 86:11 says, "Teach me your ways, O Lord, that I may live according to your truth. Grant me purity of heart so that I may honor you." So we have to have the belt. That's important. The breastplate of righteousness. And having put on what? The breastplate of righteousness. A soldier with a breastplate goes into the battle boldly with confidence. The devil is constantly attacking you with lies and accusations and reminders of your past. How many have been reminded of your past? Like you sit, you're like, I don't even know if I can go to church because I'm messed up. How can I even go to church because I feel messed up? I don't feel like I'm good enough. How many have had the, I don't feel like I'm good enough? I think we've all been there, if we're to be honest. Right? He even after you've known the Lord for a while, I think we walk through seasons where it seems like the enemy is reminding us of our past. And of course, for those of you that went to the Carmen concert last year that was here, right? And it's pretty much anybody 40 and over, let's be honest. Maybe some late 30s would know who Carmen is. But there was one song, he said, "When the devil reminds you of your past, remind him of his future." Come on, somebody. Remind him of his future. We have to have that breastplate. When we go into battle, with that breastplate, it protects us. We have this confidence that I can take a blow a little bit easier if I've got that thing covering me, covering my heart, covering me from the lies and the accusations and the constant reminders of my past. I am covered by the breastplate of righteousness. Not my righteousness, but whose righteousness? His, right? The one who is truly righteous. We just talked about this in our deacon meeting yesterday morning. The one who is truly righteous covering us. Man, that's a good place to be, having him covering us. Walking behind Daddy. He's got me covered. We must become aware of who we are in Jesus and that we have access to him. Do you know you have access to Christ? Do you get that? You, every person in this room today, has access to Christ Jesus. You need to know who you are in him. This is what Hebrews 4:16 says. "So let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace and help in our time of need." Confidence, right? Let us approach confidently, boldly approach the throne. You have a God who wants you to come to him. You have a father who wants you to come to him. That's why I could walk up those steps on that day when I was a little kid. Because my dad says, if anything goes wrong, come back to me. If you're dealing with anything, come to him. And boldly, I didn't timidly go to dad in that moment. I was like, "Dad, he did this." And I watched my dad get up. And you can do the same thing. You have a Father in heaven who so desperately loves you and covers you that all you have to do is walk in that confidence, boldly approach the throne, boldly walk into battle, but not in your strength, in his strength. So then we have the shoes of peace and preparation. Verse 15, "And as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace." Shoes allow us to what? We walk freely without fear while we can turn our full attention to the battle at hand. When I have shoes on, it helps. Okay, it's a good thing to have the right shoes. How many know it's a good thing to have the right shoes? How many have the same pair of shoes for everything you do? Some of you might. I doubt in this day and age we do. How many have a pair of shoes that you go out to mow the lawn in? Or is that the same pair you choose to go to work in? No. Is your work shoes the same pair that you use to play basketball in? Probably not. How many remember that moment as a kid? And I don't know, if you do it as adults, I don't know, I'd love to have a video camera, like a hidden video camera. But I remember as a kid, it was one of the most exciting things to go to the shoe store and get new shoes. How many remember that moment? Right? There was something about the smell of the new shoe. There was something about the look of the new shoe. For some reason, you thought that when you put the new shoe on, you were going to run faster than you had ever run before. Come on, how many know what I'm saying? Right? You slip it on, you tie those shoes up, and all of a sudden, this little kid is running back and forth in the shoe store. You're like, yep, these are the right ones, Mom. These are the right ones, Dad. Like you, all of a sudden you think you're going to jump higher than you've ever jumped, right? Because you got the new shoes on. There's something exciting. And if you do that as an adult now, that's weird. I'm just saying it's weird. You might not want to do that. Somebody's going to have a GoPro on while they do that. I want to see it. It allows us to walk freely. They aid in movement, in defense, having the grip that you need to do what you need to do. The shoes that God gives us helps us to boldly proclaim the true peace that is in Jesus Christ. If you try to boldly proclaim in your flesh, how many have felt like, I just don't know if I can share the gospel with somebody. I'm too afraid to do that. How many have been afraid? Let's be honest, have we been afraid to share the gospel, right? Because it's kind of in us. If you do it in yourself, it's kind of like walking across gravel with bare feet. How many have done that? Some of you are good at that, and I'm not sure how that actually works. Like, you have feet of steel. But I am a tenderfoot, and I'm sorry, but I am. Right? Any small pebble hurts my feet. And so to walk across gravel, I mean, I would soon lace up my shoes if it took me an extra 5 minutes than walk 5 feet across the gravel. Because there's no confidence in movement without the shoes. You have no confidence to make a move because you don't know. And I'm telling you, when your feet are uncovered, when your feet are bare, it hurts every other part of your body. You can step on something, and it can shoot a pain right up to your brain. How many know what I'm saying? How many have had that moment? We cannot be caught without the shoes. We cannot walk in our own strength. We can't share the gospel in our own strength. It's only through Christ Jesus that you can share the gospel. Right? And you shall receive power, what? When the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witness. Right? The evidence that the Holy Spirit is in you and that you're moving out and you're sharing the gospel is you got those shoes on and you've got the Holy Spirit helping you, leading you in conversation to be a witness. You can't do it by yourself. You have to have the shoes. You have to have the shoes. Whatever. God, no matter what, help us to know we have to lace it up. We have to be excited about your shoes. I can run faster in his shoes than any other shoes I'll ever try on. It doesn't matter if it's Michael Jordan's, right? Some of you were among that season of life. You might not admit it right now, but some of you had to have the next pair of Jordans. How many remember that phase? How many remember that? How many are old enough to remember that? Like every time the next pair of Jordans are out, somebody's going to go buy them. So some people have bought every Jordan shoe and set it on the shelf. And they have the whole collection of Jordans on their shelf. Can you imagine how much money people have spent on shoes on their shelf that they'll never walk in? And yet, we have access to the greatest shoes ever. His shoes. I'm going to walk in my daddy's shoes. You remember those moments? Getting into your dad's closet. Maybe, ladies, you were getting into mom's closet and putting on her heels. Guys, please don't tell me you did that. All right? But I can remember putting my dad's boots on, though. I'll tell you that for sure. They never fit when I was a kid, but I grew into them eventually. Man, I want to be in my daddy's shoes. Because when I'm in his shoes, all of a sudden I feel like I can do anything. The shield of faith in all circumstances, take up the shield of faith, which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one. The shield not only defends our whole body, but it also defends the armor, the stuff behind it. The shield of faith has a specific function. It extinguishes all the flaming darts of the evil one. Everybody say all. See? We got to read it as a whole. It doesn't extinguish most of them. It extinguishes all of them. That clip, that earlier clip, to see those arrows coming at you. Can you imagine if that was like real? I mean, it was real for somebody. But can you imagine if all of a sudden we were all sitting here and we were inserted into that movie and we were those people and all of a sudden we see these arrows, these flaming arrows coming through the sky right at us and you have no shield? How many know that's a pretty helpless moment? Like, it's, whoa, this is not going to end good. And the shield is there, and you thought, you know what? The shield is big enough to cover me, and I'm going to put that shield of faith up and trust that all those arrows are going to go out, and they're going to stick in the shield. It's going to protect me from those arrows. And it's not a few of them. It extinguishes all the flaming darts of the evil one. And the shield moves with me on my attack. If I go this way, the shield is there. If I go this way, the shield is still there. It's protecting me, that shield of faith. You have to put your faith and your trust in Jesus Christ, and you have to have that shield at all times. The helmet of salvation. And take the helmet of salvation. What's Satan's target? In most cases, what would you think Satan's target is? Your mind, folks. The battlefield, right? It's in the mind. You deal with thoughts, with fears, with worries, with prejudice, with anger, with all the things that try to destroy you. Most of those things are in your mind. And what is his weapon? Lies. He lies to you. He lies to you about your future. He lies to you about what's going to happen this week. He lies to you about your job. He lies to you about your marriage relationship. He fights that way. He is the father of lies, and he fights in your mind, and you have to put on that helmet of salvation. The enemy wants you to doubt God. He wants you to doubt your salvation. I have met people that seemingly have come to receive Christ on a weekly basis. I'm being serious about that. You ask people, do you want to accept Christ? And they get to that place where they really want a genuine relationship with Christ. And they say, yes, I'm going to pray and ask Christ into my life. And somehow, between this week and next week, I could ask that very same question, and somebody would say, yes, I need Christ again. Folks, Christ is with you. He's not going to leave you. He will never forsake you. Now, it's true. If you're here in this room and you do not have a relationship with the Father, you need one today. You should not walk out of this place without giving your heart and your life to Jesus Christ, without stepping into his armor, without walking behind him. Because if you're walking through this world alone, you are in a very precarious situation. You should be walking with Jesus, but you need to know that when Jesus comes into your heart, he is with you. You do not need to doubt your salvation, because when he does it right. Whom the Son has set free is free indeed, right? He didn't kind of save you. When Jesus died for you, if you just accept that, he saved you completely through and through. Your past is in your past, and your future is in his hands. Put on the helmet of salvation. Do not doubt. Don't let Satan lie to you about anything. Cover yourself. Cover your head. 1 Thessalonians 5:8 says, "But let us who live in the light be clear-headed, protected by the armor of faith and love, and wearing as our helmet the confidence of our salvation." Come on. Let us wear the confidence of our salvation. Walk out of here today knowing that you are in him and he is in you, that you are a child of the living God, that you can boldly approach the throne, the sword of the Spirit. And the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Folks, I cannot declare this stronger. A person who has faith in Jesus Christ that does not open their Bible on a regular basis is a person that still has not come to the revelation of who he really is. You can't accept Jesus Christ into your life and then never pick up the scripture that he wants you to have in you so you can walk victoriously. Now, you can accept Jesus Christ and know that he is your salvation, but you'll never have an effective walk on this planet. Not if you don't get into the Word and let it change you and shape you and mold you. And it's not always easy. How many have found that there's times you've had seasons, maybe you've had a bunch of them, that it was tough for you to get into God's Word on a regular basis? It's tough for you to open up the Bible regularly. How many have had those seasons, okay? I think we all have. We have to be honest about that. But what I want you to do is I want you to be an overcoming church. I want us to be more than conquerors. I want us to walk boldly, and you can't walk boldly if you aren't sure of what the next move is. A great wrestler knows three moves prior to the move he's currently on. I had one of my guys that I graduated with. He was a two-time state champion. And he always knew moves. He was out moving the guy he was wrestling, thinking him way in advance. Michael, tell me I'm not telling the truth. You have to be out in advance. You have to know. The enemy is crafty. He's going to come after you. You got to know how to outmove him. Jesus didn't get stumped in the desert. Right? Was Jesus tempted? How many know Jesus went through a time of temptation? And when he got into the desert and the enemy said, "You need to make this stone, turn it into bread." And Jesus was like, "What? That sounds right. I mean, I'm hungry." Jesus wasn't stumped in the desert, folks. Jesus said to the enemy, "Thou shalt not live on bread alone, but by what? By every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God." That's how we live. That's how we move. That's how we breathe. That's how we defeat the enemy. The word is the sword. There is all of a sudden this confidence I have. Right? There's 400 of you. But I'm a lot more confident right now. Come on, who wants? Because the issue is this. Who wants to be the first? Right? Who wants to be the first? I mean, 400 is a big number. 450 is a big number. But who's coming first? All of a sudden, you have a confidence when you have the Word. You have the sword of the Spirit. You have the Spirit of the living God living in you. There is strength in the sword. You need to pick it up. You need to pick it up. You need to get used to it in your hand. Like I'm telling you, when I first got this sword, it was given to me actually by a church that I pastored at before. And I'm telling you, I was actually scared for a bit. Like, I didn't really want to chop a part of my body off with it. You know, you watch these people wield these swords, right? I'm not going to chop part of my body off. But I mean, you watch them do that, and you see these movies, right?
and where they're just like going all over the place. Like I would come back here and lose a limb. I mean, my left arm is gone. You know? And then it's gotta be a Monty Python thing like
that didn't hurt. Now you gotta be a little up in years to know what I'm saying when I say that. Right? It's only a flesh wound. That didn't hurt. Now, I'm telling you, it really does. But if you don't ever pick it up, if you don't get used to the word in your hand, the sword in your hand, you're never going to have the confidence. Well, I don't know where the New Testament is. Well, open it up. You may miss a few times, but eventually you're going to find where the New Testament is. It's towards the back. And the Old Testament is towards the front. If you want to know where the book of Psalms is, you can almost just let your Bible flop open and accidentally hit the book of Psalms. But you're not going to know until you do it. You're not going to know where the books of the Bible are until you start memorizing them. Right? You can look in the index. You can do that all day long. But at some point in time, you got to know where it's at. You got to know how to make the right cut. You got to know when the enemy attacks you, this is the move I make that wins the battle. But you're not going to know that if you don't get confident in the sword. Now, I want you to see all these as a whole. We have to trust in the truth of God's word. We have to have confidence in Him. The last one is prayer. Verse 18, praying at all times in the Spirit. Everybody say, praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keeping alert with all perseverance, making supplication for the saints, making prayers for the saints. Stay alert. Why? Because the enemy is like a what? I'm going to give you one more chance. The enemy is like, and I'll even help just a little bit. The enemy is like a roaring, yes, seeking whom he may devour. So stay alert at all times. Pray at all times. Be filled with the Spirit of God. It's 11:32. We need to be done. Fortunately for you, I am. We need to pray, folks. There are kingdoms that are colliding every day. You can't see them, but they are real. And we need to be a church that is alert. We need to be a church in our word. We need a church that has the belt secured, that has the breastplate, that has the helmet, that has the shield, that has the shoes, that has the sword. We need to be a church that's fully equipped. Wake up tomorrow and equip yourself, but don't do it in your own strength. Do it in Dad's strength. Do it in your Father's strength. Look at his armor and step into it. Step into it. Step into it. Let's pray. Father in heaven, I give you praise. I worship you even right now. Before anything else happens in this day, I give you my praise. You have won every victory. You have won every battle. We can have confidence in you. I step into the full armor that you have available for me. And when I step into your power, into your armor, I don't have to forget. I can just rest in you. And the enemy can try to bring whatever he wants to bring my way, but it's not going to matter because you have equipped me in your armor to extinguish all the fiery darts. Everything he would do to try to destroy my mind, my heart, my life. I'm protected in you. And when you raise your voice, the enemy listens. So would you raise your voice on behalf of this body today? We come to you knowing that kingdoms are colliding all over, all around us, in every family. In every situation, there's something colliding in the spiritual realm. There's a battle at hand. And I just declare right now, victory in the name of Jesus for every family in this church. Victory for every individual, whatever they're facing, whatever they're going through. Right now, in Jesus' name, I declare victory. because you are great and mighty and victorious. I would simply ask that if you're here and you'd say, Pastor Brett, I want to be on the winning team. I want to walk in confidence in my Father. I don't know that I've done that. You need to know. Listen, if you've accepted Christ, you need to walk in that and live in it and have confidence in it. But if you're not sure if Christ is the Lord of your life, you're not sure if heaven's your home, today is the day you don't walk out of this place without making that commitment in your heart, that you would speak that boldly to say, here I am, I want to be a child of God, a victorious child of God. I want to live this life not defeated, but walking in His power. Come on, if you're here, every head bowed, every eye closed, if you're here and you would so boldly look at me and raise your hand and say, Pastor Brett, pray for me. I don't know where I'm at with Christ, but today I want to make a firm commitment and have Christ in my life. Would you raise your hand and look at me right now? Thank you. Thank you. Anybody else? Thank you. Who else in this place? You say, today is my day. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. There's 6, 7. Thank you. Anybody else? I want everybody to pray this prayer with me, because I believe in my heart, but with my mouth I declare it. I want everybody to pray this prayer with me, and as we pray this prayer, those of you that have raised your hand, you need to walk in confidence from this moment on that Jesus Christ is your Lord and your Savior, and then you need to walk in His power, not in your own strength anymore. You need to be plugged in. You need to let God move in your life. You need to open the Bible. If you need to come to me or one of the pastors or somebody and you need help with that, we will gladly walk with you. But let's pray this prayer in confidence to say, today is my day that I'm accepting Christ Jesus as Lord and Savior. I'm not going to have a doubt anymore. And as you pray this prayer with me, know that God is going to transform your life. Let's pray it boldly and loudly all across this place. Dear Jesus, I thank you for this day, that you are alive and that you love me and that you have won the battle already. I thank you that you defeated death, that you defeated hell and the grave. Forgive me of my sin. Cleanse me of unrighteousness. The Bible declares that old things have passed away, and behold, all things are new. That I am new right now in Jesus Christ. That my past is in the past, and my future is secure. Thank you, Jesus, for loving me. Now I step into your armor. Shield me. Cover me. Walk with me. Go before me. I am victorious in you. Amen.